Hello, welcome back to my channel. In this new video, I would like to show you the restoration and repair works I have been doing on a great Technics FM tuner. I hope you enjoy this video, and again, thank you very much for your attention. The Technics tuner, which is the subject of this video, is shown here in this picture below. This is paired with another vintage unit, which is a Marantz amplifier. We will not speak about that now, but again, we will speak about the Technics tuner you can see below in the picture. As you can see, a gorgeous unit, really built like a tank. This is the high-level schematics for the Technics tuner. I think this gives us the possibility to deeply understand how an FM tuner is laid out. We can identify three main areas. On top we can see the front end. The front end converts the RF incoming signal, the frequency being any from 87.5 to 108 MHz, converts this frequency into an intermediate frequency, which is 10.7 MHz. The second part, the second macro part within this picture, is the intermediate frequency amplifier, filter and detector. The role of this part is to amplify the incoming 10.7 MHz signal from the front end, filter it. We will see that this is a very important task for sake of the tuner quality, and convert this 10.7 MHz radio signal into an audio signal through the detector. This second part supports other facilities, other features, like the muting, the tuning meter, and the signal strength meter. Then the audio signal I have at the output of the second part we have seen before is fed into the input of the third macro area, which is the stereo decoder, or MPX. The role of the stereo decoder is, as the name suggests, to get a complete stereo signal, a stereo audio signal, from the incoming monophonic audio signal I get at the output of the second section of the tuner. Let's now give a deeper look at the first macro area of my tuner, which is the front end. As we said before, the role of this circuit, of this front end circuit, is to convert the frequency of the incoming signal into an intermediate frequency, which is 10.7 MHz. Here we have a very complex front end, a very high quality one. You can guess by looking at the dotted lines. As you can see, the dotted lines connect eight different variable capacitor sections. So this front end is an 8-gang front end, which is a really, really high quality. So we have a very complex mechanical variable capacitor built with eight different sections. Each section of this capacitor has a different role. The six sections reported on the top of this picture are RF filters. As you can see, in fact, the incoming signal you can see on the left is filtered with the first two sections, then amplified with the MOSFET you can see here, then again other two filters, then again another MOSFET which further amplifies the signal, and then we have the final two filtering sections, and then on the right we have the mixer, which as the name suggests mixes the incoming radio signal with another signal which is generated by the circuit you can see on the bottom of this picture, which is the local oscillator. As you can see, the local oscillator has other two sections of this great variable capacitor. One section is used for the oscillator itself, another section is used for the amplifier within the oscillator in order to get low impedance for the local oscillator signal. The front end is structured in a way that the difference between the received signal and the oscillator signal, the frequency, is exactly 10.7 MHz. You can imagine that in order to do that properly, all the eight sections of the front end need to be exactly adjusted and synchronized among them. And this is one of the main tasks when restoring a such beautiful FM tuner. Let's now examine the second part of my circuit, and within this second part we have the two intermediate frequency strip line, so-called strip line. So as you can see, we have two different strips of intermediate frequency amplifier and filters. These are the I would say most important part for sake of audio quality. Here is where the tuner selectivity and audio quality is set. Selectivity and audio quality do not come together, so the more selectivity I have, so the narrower my passband is, the higher the distortion. On the contrary, the lower the tuner's selectivity, which means the wider the intermediate frequency bandwidth, the lower the distortion as well. In this case, we have two different IF strips, so two different filtering and amplifier stages for the intermediate frequency signal. The narrow filtering is accomplished through ceramic filters, as you can see here on top of this picture. The wider filtering is accomplished through this very good GDT filter, which can provide an optimum group delay for the maximum audio quality. The narrower bandwidth filtering and amplification stage supports two facilities as well. One is the muting. The muting is a circuit which shut down the audio output in case of no station received or weak station received. The threshold is adjustable. So this is very handy when dialing between stations, just in order to avoid hearing noises between stations. The second facility is the strength meter, which again is driven by the same narrow band filtering and amplification stage. This was exactly the part which was faulty when I received the tuner. The tuner could work in wide bandwidth mode, but couldn't work in narrow bandwidth, and furthermore the strength meter and the muting didn't work. So I had to replace one integrated circuit, the CA3089E, you can see here, and then this solved the issue. So now the tuner is perfectly working. The IF switching unit is the one which allows the user to select between the two intermediate frequency strips. So after one of the two is selected, my signal, which remember is still a radio signal, the frequency is 10.7 MHz, my signal goes to other amplifying stages and then to the detector. The detector is the unit which converts my 10.7 MHz radio signal to an audio signal. This audio signal I have at the output of the detector is still a monophonic signal. This is then fed to the input of the stereo decoder. You see PLLMPX. This is the stereo decoder, which gets the monophonic audio signal at the input and creates the stereo signal. How can the stereo decoder extract the full stereo signal, the two channels, left and right, from a monophonic signal? The stereo signal transmitted by a FM station over the air is composed by the following part. First part is a monophonic signal, frequency modulated, which is composed by the two stereo channels summed together. So here we have the sum left plus right audio signal, and this is done for retro compatibility. So if I have a monophonic tuner which cannot receive stereo, this tuner can perfectly receive the monophonic signal in this way. But this left plus right, or right plus left, the same of course, is not the only component. As you can see, the component on the right is the difference between the two stereo channels. This signal is amplitude modulated around the 38 kHz carrier. So you can understand that the stereo decoder is doing exactly the reverse from what the station, the FM station, did when transmitting the signal over the air. And in this way, the stereo decoder can perfectly reconstruct, let's say, each one of the two stereo channels. Here you can see a beautiful view of the tuner, of the internal part of the tuner. On the right, going anti-clockwise, starting from the right, you can see the great 8-section variable capacitor and the global front end. Then we have the two intermediate frequency amplifier and filtering stages. Here we have additional intermediate frequency amplifier stages. Then we have the audio demodulator, the stereo decoder, and the final audio output section. As I reported before, in order to bring this tuner back to the full operation, I had to replace this integrated circuit in the narrow IF amplifier and filtering stage. Then I properly realigned the front end. Every one of the 8 sections of the front end has a tiny variable capacitor, a tiny trimmer, I would say, and it is very important to carefully align one by one the 8 sections in order to have the maximum sensitivity and selectivity of the tuner. Finally, I realigned the intermediate frequency stages, those which needed, of course, because many filtering stages within the IF strip are accomplished through ceramic filters, which of course do not need any adjustment. At the end, I adjusted the audio detector for the minimum distortion. So this great FM tuner is back to life, ready for other 10th years of operation, and I'm glad this gave me the opportunity to speak a little bit in general about FM tuners in this video. Thank you very much for your attention.